Hi. All right, so I'm going to talk to you today about digital anthropology and how it can contribute to the world of UX. We're going to start by talking about what is ethnography. All right. And then how is it used by different companies and in different scenarios and outside academia, and why? And finally, how can you use ethnography and can become an ethnographer in your work and in your projects? So some practical tips on doing ethnography. So a bit about me, I studied digital anthropology in UCL in London, and it's a very special department that brings together the world of digital technologies and tools and communication with the studies of cultures and communities and groups. And we study how those things have a dialogue together and how each digital product is emerged within a subjective cultural context. I did my research about the future of the family photo album, and I was trying to find out if the photo album still exists in a digital age. And I had all those insights about how people store their photos. Speaking of moms, I usually interviewed moms and how they were in charge of organizing the photos and preserving the photos and so on. And I had all those insights about archiving and memories and so on, and I thought it's a shame if only my supervisor reads it and nothing happens with it. So I developed it into a product, a service design in which we used to go to people's houses and we would help them organize their photos in a way that is very specific to them. And we would understand their story, the story of their family and their memories, and they would get a little library on a USB stick that has all their photos, their old photos, their new photos, and so on. So this was a way of bringing ethnography and research into a service design. This is my grandmother, and a few weeks ago, she asked me to come with her to buy a computer, and when we went to the store, I suggested that she gets an iPad, because I thought it's much easier for her to click, to touch directly the commands that she wants to. It will be more intuitive for her, and it's easier for her to carry it around and so on. And she was a bit suspicious, but she got it. But after a few days, she went behind my back and returned it and got a laptop. And I think there are a few reasons for this. First of all, there's this notion that she thought that if something is smaller, it needs to be much cheaper. It shouldn't be that's much more expensive. And but also, I think she felt like this wasn't for her. This was for someone else. This was meant to be used by someone else. And that made me think about inclusion and who do we think about when we design, and how much our design can make a difference and an impact actually to people that we don't consider when we have a product. This is my partner's nephew, and he takes about 100 photos like this an hour. And I find it fascinating the way the meaning of photography has shifted amongst teenagers. Because I think of a photo as a souvenir or as a memorabilia, and they think about it as a means of communication, as a very instant, spontaneous way to communicate. But generally, the meaning of social media for teenagers is an incredible thing, and we can learn a lot about how they're using it if we move away from the simplistic notion of they're addicted to it or they don't know how to behave and so on. But we just think about how it empowers them and the sort of culture that they have around it. Is quite interesting, so I would usually interview him in any family gathering. And I collect all those stories because I'm interested in anthropology. And when we think of anthropology, we usually think about the classical sort of European or American researcher that goes into an exotic, distant tribe and just lives with them for a year, learn the language, learn the systems of culture and meanings in that place, and then translates it into their world. But anthropology has actually gone a long way since, and it can be about the most modern things. We can do an anthropology about today, about us, about here, and we find that things like jeans and iPads are not less exotic. So we moved from researching this type of technology and these kind of tools, and we can now research these tools. and look at how they influence our culture and what is their meaning and what are the stories that they tell. But there are some things that are very similar, and I'm going to give two examples of a classic anthropology and a modern anthropology to show you the similar and the different things. So this is Margaret Mead is a classical American anthropologist, and she has studied youth in Samoa. And she was trying to find out if how we think about teenagers, we often ascribe sort of biological qualities to them. We claim that because they're in a transitional stage, then they are frustrated and they're rebellious and they have all we ascribe a lot of sort of biological qualities to them because of their age. And she was trying to see, well, maybe this is a Western thing. Maybe the qualities that we ascribe to them are different. And she lived with teenagers in Samoa, and she found out that their experiences are very different because, first of all, they're part of the community. They're not excluded in school. They work and they take an action inside the community. And second of all, their sexual life is much more loose, and they get married in a later stage. So there's a lot of different environmental factors that has changed the idea. And she was saying we should think about the environmental influence. This is a classic digital anthropology conducted by Daniel Miller about mothers who immigrated from the Philippines to work across the world. And they basically don't see their kids for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. And how is the idea of a mother and our cultural imagination about what a mother should be changes when she migrates and she doesn't see us? And then how does technologies like mobile phones and Skype navigate and negotiate the kid's idea of the mother and the mother's idea of how she should be, and then the mother that actually emerges on Skype? So technology mediates a lot of different cultural ideas, and we need to look at how our idea about a mother can change according to the ecosystem and the technological system. So what is common to both of those things is that we're trying to understand people in their own terms. We're not judging them. We're trying to really get into their world, and we put an emphasis on the social and cultural relations. And anthropology generally is influenced by other disciplines, such as the post-colonialism, in which we try to look at other groups and other cultures not from a superior point of view, but kind of try to challenge our ideas about top and bottom and ugly and beautiful, good and bad, and we try to look at things in a more complex way. Postmodernism as well, trying to challenge the truth and what is the truth, and trying to look for multiple truth, and gender studies. The main methodology that we're talking about when we say anthropology is ethnography, which is a holistic fieldwork. It's when we go out and we spend time in our participants' natural environment, in their whole context. We try to really understand their lives and the different aspects of their lives, and not just look at a specific point in their lives. What we're trying to gain is an access, and an intimate access to someone else, to someone that we wouldn't meet on a daily basis, that we won't have interaction with them. And we're trying to see what can we learn from them. How can we... It takes time, but we need to start and gain enough time and enough intimacy with someone else that we can actually learn something meaningful from someone that we normally don't think about when we do research, when we do design. And we can do this completely on a virtual basis as well. So we can do a virtual ethnography, a cyber anthropology, and just look at how people behave online and just go into that field and try to meet people online as well. And the company I work with right now, Bazila, what they're doing is they scan discussions in different social networks, and they try to analyze the discussions and the topics that are coming up in the social networks, and what are people saying when and how and so on. So this is a type of a virtual ethnography. What we're also trying to do is we're trying to see how what is familiar to us and what is so taken for granted in our world can actually be quite strange, and what is strange has a lot of logic to it. And this is when our minds really open and we can really improve the way we think about design. In my work about the future of the family photo album, I worked with families from Ghana. And what I saw that in their photo albums, they have an immense amount of photos from funerals. And for me, that was a strange thing, because in my culture, taking a photo in a funeral is quite intrusive, it's rude, it's not something that I would do. But in their culture, a funeral is a celebration of someone's life that brings together everyone from all the family members and the community members. People take flights especially for that, put on their best clothes, best food, and so on. So it will be crazy not to take a photo of it and kind of put it aside from all the chain of family memories. So alongside weddings and so on, you can see a lot of photos from funerals. And today we see these shifts, and we can see photos from funerals happening even in the Western world. And we can see how those things change, and digital technologies can change cultural norms and influence how we preserve our memories in different contexts. This is John Cheapchase, and he started as Nokia's anthropologist. He then moved on to an agency called Frog. And he's saying, if you want a big idea, you need to embrace everyone on the planet. That's the first thing. So that relates to the idea of universal design as well. And what he's basically doing is going into the streets of places like Uganda, Afghanistan, Tokyo, and he's trying to see how people use technology in the most basic level in their daily lives in those surprising places. And he can learn so much about innovation and about how technology is deconstructed and reconstructed to support financial needs and social needs and so on. And he can actually learn very surprising insights by looking at other places. And I love this infographic about if the world were a village of 100 people, because I think that a lot of time when we design, we have in mind those 12 people and then maybe half of these, the North America. And we kind of have this idea of the other people they're going to take on, they're going to join if they want, but they're not in our minds when we design services. And more companies are realizing that this is an immense amount of people that use technology, that embrace technology, but they have a different system of meaning and understanding around technology that we need to understand, and that we can make an impact if we think larger about the world and if we have a bigger picture. The question is, what does this person, if he's a very talented designer with an old phone, what does he, as much as he has the expertise and the knowledge, how much would he know about those people? How much would he know about what they're looking for in technology and what they need from their technology? So the idea of an anthropologist is really to be the voice outside, to break out of the offices, to go into the field and find technology and digital tools in their most surprising places and contexts, and really see how they're used outside of our regular daily lives. More and more companies are doing this, and Microsoft has 200 anthropologists today, and they're really trying to gain a global impact by understanding cultural contexts. And this is a company called Red Associates, and they're based in Denmark and New York, and they also do social science and ethnography for different companies, and they're doing very well. And an interesting case study that they did is for Absolut Vodka. And Vodka were asking them, we want to know why people buy our alcohol. Why would they choose a certain type of alcohol over the other? And what Red did is they sent ethnographers into house parties, and they just sort of spent time in the house parties. That's what you do in ethnography. You participate in the natural environment of the people you research. And what they found out is what happens is that each person brings their own alcohol to the house party, and when they enter to the party, they would explain what alcohol they brought, and there would be this table with all the different bottles that everyone brought, and it would kind of be lost in the mess. But the one meaningful moment was that moment when I enter with my bottle and I show it to the host and I tell them, yeah, I brought this because we had it one time in our vacation there, or because it's made there. And so there was a certain of storytelling, an element of storytelling around the bottle that I brought. And for Absolut Vodka, this was actually revolutionary to shift from the emphasis on the visual and the shapes of their brand into the story that their brand tells you. So this was very important for them. Because it says about an experience. When we think about Amazon, we don't think about that tangible, we don't realize that there's a whole system of very sort of material world around it, because we get an experience, we get something that is very clean and so on. So the physical quantities of something are not necessarily the whole story. We need to think about how we transform the physical qualities into a cultural context. This is Genevieve Bell, and she's an anthropologist in Intel. And she's saying, knowing what people do with technology today can help you make the technology for tomorrow. It kind of continues what Jan was saying, that we, by understanding what people love and don't love about technology and what they value about it, we can actually invent better technology. And being an anthropologist in Intel is quite a strange thing, because Intel is a microprocessing company, so they don't actually create the technology, they do the chips. But she has managed to kind of revolutionize a lot of perceptions in Intel, because she basically realized that Intel were making very, very heavy, complex, and expensive chips that were based on the American user. And when she was studying how people are using the chips in other places in the world, she saw that they're using it for much lighter things like text and less multimedia. So they started making much lighter and cheaper chips, which really made them grow around the world. Another thing that she realized is they were trying to see why the laptops with their chips are not selling. And we think of a laptop in the West as a very personal object. It's a very individual thing. It's a personal computer. And when this was trying to be sold around the world, and especially in Asia, the idea of a laptop or anything that you buy into the household, the idea of the self is much more extended into a community. So we would have a social unit. We would have a family. And when we buy something, it cannot be just for me. It has to be for everyone. So how do we design a laptop that is not based on the Western idea of an individual, but on the non-Western idea of a community and about multiple users using the same thing? So this was also a change that she brought. And all those things are the most natural place for those researchers to happen is in the UX world. And I think anthropology should have a much bigger presence in the UX world, because we're trying to design the user experience. The question is, who do we think about when we say user? And the silhouette here is of a white male, and I don't think it's a coincidence. I don't think it's a coincidence that most of the UX industry is based on white males. And this comes with a certain set of privileges and of cultural subjectivities that is very hard to understand. And when we do UX research and we invite people to our labs, we usually invite people that are similar to us, that are our friends or people from our world, and we stay within that echo chamber of our privileges and our subjective understanding of the world. So we kind of prevent our innovation from growing. The UX has so many different disciplines within it. As it was said earlier, it is kind of a huge umbrella that brings different elements. And if we think about the stages of a classical UX, it would be the research and then the design, which has the information design, the interaction design, and the visual design, and then the evaluation. And for me, each one of those is the whole art. It's a whole profession. It's something that is huge. But when we have to do all of them in a limited set of time, we often kind of go through the research bit pretty quickly, and we have to focus on that fiddly part of really organizing the information, creating the wireframes, because we don't have time to do research. But if we turn that around and we say we don't have time not to do research, we have to do research, and we have to bring that profession into the UX world as the art on itself. There are a variety of methods to do research in UX. These are some of them. And when we are thinking about including anthropology and ethnography, we're mostly putting it into the site visits, the contextual inquiries, and the in-depth interviews. So this is when we combine both of them, we create a type of applied ethnography. When we think about service design as well, the idea is that service design brings together, that it's the magic formula that brings together a problem, a solution, and the production of that solution. But to find a problem, to find a need, to identify that need, and to find a solution to that is the part that we actually had the invention. There's a problem, lots of photos are messy and deteriorating, and people don't know how to organize them and what to do with them. And then there's a solution, like a simple solution that was entwined into a problem that was identified in the field. So when we think about the problem, we have to track and expose a need. And this is when we do the observation and the interviews. And then we develop an idea that answered that need. And there are so many products that I hear about and that people tell me, and they put all this money and all this time, and I ask them, who needs that? Like, why would someone need that? So we need to really step back a few steps and make sure that someone needs it. And that's when we do the design and prototyping, and then we have the production and the sales. What we want to really put more emphasis on is this part, tracking and exposing a need by doing research. And what's amazing about it is if we put more emphasis on this element, we actually have a guideline, a prototype that helps us throughout all the elements until the sales. Because when we come to market our product, when we come to introduce the application that we designed, we know our users, we know why they need it, we know their world, so it's already easy. And it guides us throughout the design process as well. If we think about colors, when we have a cultural idea about the colors that we're using, if I'm doing a Chinese wedding website and I'm using white, this is actually a color of death. So we need to think about, once I've done my cultural research, I can guide myself into my design. Think about body language and gestures and what do they mean in different places of the world. This can mean, you can go really wrong with those stuff. And think about associations and the way we organize our information. If I think about orange, company orange, or the orange. So the associations in different places and amongst different groups can be very different. We can assume that they would make a certain link between things that they might not do. So I'm going to end with some tips. First of all, when do we use ethnography? So it is really about understanding local cultural context. And it could be ours or someone else's. It could be when we're entering a particular consumer market, if we want to understand a certain group, a specific group that could be in our country or in another country and so on. Learn how products are used on a daily basis, which can be incredibly different than how we imagine. So when we design something, we have this idea about how it's going to be used, and then it's used in very different ways. We constantly improvise around our technology and put it into a different context. And understanding behavior during purchase, so we can accompany people as they purchase, as they make a consuming or use, and we try to understand how they behave. And of course, expose the problems and needs. And not every research that we do has to have a definite sort of end result. It's not about, I'm doing ethnography to know where to put that button. Some of it can be about really having sort of open-ended insights and ideas that will accompany us in certain ways that we're not even aware of. So it doesn't have to be that absolute. It can be about enriching ourselves and our understanding, and this will actually improve our design. I saw this application, Human, do you know it? Yeah? So it's basically this application realized that all of the phone books that we're using is based on alphabetical order, but the way that we remember our contacts is not alphabetical. We think about contexts in a more social way, according to communities, according to the people we met, how close are they to us, where did we meet them. And they're trying to change the idea of how you organize your contacts in your phone. And this is a very social, anthropological approach to design already. And I don't know if they've done the research in order to know exactly how to put a certain button where, but I know that it changed their approach. So a quality that each ethnographer should have is to be very patient, because it takes time to gain the confidence and the trust amongst the people that you spend time with. You have to be very curious about different people and about different cultures. Non-judgmental. We're not trying to say if it's good or bad and ugly. And it's really fascinating to go into the ugliest websites and to the ugliest things that you can think of and see how they work for certain people and why they work, and kind of really try to open your mind, because these are subjective things a lot of time. open-minded, and very descriptive. We talk about thick description. We have to really bring the entire world that we've been to in the field, where you visited in this island and you're trying to bring that. So you have to be descriptive. And the most importantly, empathy. So we're trying to really feel how other people experience the world, and we're trying to be in their shoes and trying to understand their model of thoughts and emotions and bring that into our design. When we recruit participants, we have to really well define our participants and who they are and why are they in our research and what is the meaning of that. We have to find that one person within that community that will be our key into that community and will help us sort of snowball and bring us more contacts. And we think about how to reward them. And this doesn't have to be a tangible reward like money, but it can be the mere idea of the fact that they're included in our design and that we care about what they think and how they use things. So we need to think about how we give them a sense of value. And then we basically hang out with them. You just take your time and you hang out with them and try to just, if you go to the supermarket with them, then you go also to their house and see how they take out their products and what do they cook with it later on, and just try to be with them for as long as possible. When you're in the field, you need to notice the places and the environments and the actors and the events and the objects. The material world around us is very meaningful. We don't have to only think about people and relations. We can think about the objects and the artifacts around them and the meanings that they carry. And these can be digital artifacts and non-digital artifacts. And we can learn a lot from non-digital artifacts as well. When we go into an interview, we really have to kind of capture the world of the person that we're interviewing and in the most detailed way. What I would do is use open-ended questions, so not yes or no questions, but just try to be as wide as possible. Get their entire story, but not just how do you use this website, but how do you use the internet, how do you spend your day? So I would go as far as in a holistic way. I would do more listening and less talking, but I will also make a conversation, because you're basically exploring something with them. They're participants in your exploration. So you can share things as well and have a conversation and discover something with them, which is usually the moment when there's a meaningful insight. Think about the time that you are willing to invest. And I'm coming back to the point of there's no time, there's no money for research. Turn it around and say there's no money not to do research. So we have to do research. You can do one-day research, and you can do a year, 6 months research, or a month. But anything that you invest into at any time and the meaning that you have behind it is important. And then think about how that research doesn't get lost on the way and how you really integrate it into the rest of the team, how you deliver your findings and how you kind of sit down with the graphic designers and the product managers and you really try to bring that world that you found and see how those things emerge within the remaining part of the research. And I just want to end with the notion of big data that we hear about everywhere, and there's this sort of euphoria that we can know everything about everyone now because of big data. And that's a very dangerous area, because we can know that how many people clicked that button at what time, but we don't know why they clicked it and what they did before and where. And we have to really get into a different system of meanings around and understanding around things. And I think exactly at this age, when we think that globalization has made all of us the same and big data has made every information accessible, this is exactly the time that qualitative research is required from us, and to understand the particularities and the differences and the localities of different people. Thank you.